is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you, and this one's going to be like no other gardening video you've ever seen. It's probably one of the most important videos you guys want to watch on gardening because it espouses the benefits of gardening besides just actually being able to grow some of the best food and eat that food yourself, plant foods that are high antioxidant, the best in the world. This video is actually going to get into the specifics on functional exercise and why it's important to get exercise, how you can get exercise in your garden. This is why I got my big one. I don't have super huge guns, but I literally don't go to the gym. I hate gyms. I shun all gyms. I want you guys to get real world exercise. You know, I lift boxes for my job. I go garden like all the time. And this is why I'm in fit and in shape. You know, I do gardening on a regular basis, but do very specific things in garden. I'm not just like a couch potato gardener. And, you know, I have a really good diet. And today I have a special guest, John Pierre, or known as JP. He's a fitness and nutritional consultant coach, if you want to call it. He's coached some famous movie stars. Not to make that any better or worse than coaching anybody else, but he's helped so many people along his journey. And so he's literally going to, because he's into fitness and personal training, he knows all the muscle groups. He's like, John, that workout you're doing there, which I don't know what it works out, is working out this, and this is working out this, and, you know, we're just having fun over at my composters, just like I'm showing them all the exercises I do, which I make up in my head because I don't really know, and I rotate to make sure I get different muscle groups, you know, worked, and he's going to go over that. So, JP, do you want to explain more about you and who you are for my viewers that may have never seen you before?
Sure. Hi, everybody. I'm John Pierre, and I'm with Living with Harmony. So we're an animal sanctuary and retreat center out in Boulder, Colorado. And I've been vegan for a little bit over 36 years and been teaching nutrition and fitness for about 30 years. And interestingly enough, everyone always associates me with celebrities or athletes, but my background's actually in geriatrics.
Oh, wow.
So 25 years ago, I started the first brain building programs in the United States out in Chicago using a plant-based diet and then nutraceuticals, so certain nutrients for the brain, and then different exercises physically where we would do physical exercises to develop what we call neuroplasticity for the brain, and then a lot of different mental exercises. So I work with lots of different groups of people, but the geriatrics has always been a passion of mine.
Wow, yeah, no, that's very important, especially most people in a garden are usually older, so it's very important to keep your brain active. And I mean, I like some of the, you know, I run experiments in my garden, always keep me thinking, always planting new plants. What if I planted this here and this there and kind of create some new things going on in my brain?
Yeah, and what's interesting about gardening is when I work with clients, we do what I call more functional or real-world training, and I always tell them the two best movements or activities you could do in your life are gardening and housework. So a lot of the exercises that you see at gyms kind of mimic gardening. So when you see people holding a plank, right, you've seen a plank, well, that's basically getting on your hands and knees and working in the garden. That's all core work.
Oh, wow.
So gardening and housework is where it's at. Not only is it will keep you like you are, very functionally fit, but also you're getting something done, and the key thing is you're having a connection to nature. When you're in a gym, you know, you've got attendants running around with toxic sprays, you've got toxic air, right? You've got all this pollution, indoor air pollution. Here, you're outside getting fresh air and greenery. You're getting literally all the microorganisms and even bacteria on your skin. That's healthy for you.
Yeah, and you're even getting the sun to make your own vitamin D, so you have to take a supplement and be vitamin D deficient, of course, during the right time of year, depending on where you live.
Absolutely. Yeah, because vegans, that's our source of vitamin D, is the sun. And people are shunning it, and most people are working indoors all the time, and they're not getting sun. So where's their vitamin D? And, you know, we have vitamin D receptors in our brain, and when you don't get enough vitamin D, one of the main problems you get is mild to moderate depression. Mm. So we got to get that sun in, for sure. And not only is it a good source of vitamin D, but it just makes you feel better. So being outside as much as possible is what you want. When I train clients, we're outside as much as possible. If I could have it my way, my gym, if I was to have an outdoor gym, would basically be a garden. So just pretty much what you have here.
Exactly. Well, maybe add a few things. But, yeah, so vitamin D also very important to your sleep, you know. So, and here's the thing, like, people want to say the sun's good or the sun's bad. Everybody wants to always have this dichotomy, good, bad, right, wrong, all this kind of stuff. The sun's not good or bad. It's how we use it and how much exposure we get. You know, I live in a place that has a lots of sun exposure. So normally, you know, I always usually wear a hat in the day because I don't want too much sun on my face. But in the morning, I'll take my shirt off and I'll work in the garden with my shirt off with my hat on. So I got pretty good exposure. Sometimes I'll be in shorts or cutoffs and get really good sun exposure until my body tells, and I don't wear sunblock, until my body tells me, John, you've had enough sun today. Then I put on the world's best sunblock that's non-toxic. It's clothes. I start putting clothes up. I'll put clothes on, put a t-shirt on. So I got farmer's tan. And then I'll, you know, sometimes I'll even put like a long sleeve shirt on if I feel like I don't want any more sun, you know. And the whole sun, you know, sunscreen stuff, you know, I think, you know, we need to have internal sunscreen. And the problem with America today, in my opinion, is that people are not eating enough internal sunscreen. Our body makes our own sun protection if you're eating the right foods. What are the right foods? The right foods are the carotenoids and lutein and zeaxanthin and leafy greens and other colorful pigmented fruits like my anthocyanins and my Malabar spinach berries this time of year, right? So we really want to eat highly pigmented foods which give us sun protection from literally the inside out so that we don't get sunburned. So I mean, gardening to me is an integral portion of life for your health, not only the food you're growing, but also in many other ways. So I want you, all you guys that are not watching that may want to garden, maybe that go to gyms, cancel your gym membership and start gardening, guys. Anyways, what we're gonna do with John in this episode is we're gonna take him around the garden and I'm gonna show him some of the tasks that I commonly do, and he's gonna say what muscle groups I'm doing and what exercise it may simulate in the gym. So you wanna talk a bit more about this real quick, John?
Yeah, well, one of the things is that when you go into a gym, you're generally working muscle groups. So like say somebody does a curl, they're isolating their biceps, right? But when you're doing manual labor here and you're lifting things, not only are you working your biceps, but you're working your whole entire core and different smaller muscle groups that you wouldn't normally. Like when people do a preacher curl, right? And their arm is on a bench and they're just isolating their bicep because they just want size. Well, there's nothing wrong with it if you're a bodybuilder and you want size, but it doesn't translate to functionality. Because you might be able to do a lot of work here, but your core is weak. So when you try to lift something like this, you've got the bicep strength, but your core is gonna have a fall to it. So the stuff that you were doing here that we did already today, it's all functional stuff. It couldn't, there's nothing you could do that would be more functional than what you're doing.
And how about the anti-aging, you know, aspect of just doing functional exercise to keep your whole body and core instead of just your super huge muscles? Well, like, so why is it so important?
Well, the thing is, when you, one of the biggest challenges in the United States today, and my background's in geriatrics, we have about 10,000 deaths a year attributed to falls taken by seniors. Think about most of the movement people do aerobically is forward. They get on a treadmill, or we call it a dead mill, because you're going nowhere, right? But here in the garden, you have to move laterally, you're moving backwards. You have all sorts of different obstacles that are turning.
Well, in my garden, I have lots of obstacles.
Well, here's for sure. But you're turning, your brain is like the 4th of July because it, your nervous system is hyper alert now because it doesn't want to fall. So that's the best thing for you for fall prevention is your garden, where you have to be hyper-vigilant about everything, and it's training your balance. Sometimes when I've seen you move, you're kind of off balance, and you've got to regain your balance. When you're regaining your balance, that's your core and everything getting you back to its state of, you know, balance. So it's perfect. House cleaning and gardening, it couldn't be any better. That's why the old-timers that lived a long time ago, the people that I actually worked with, their parents especially, were very, very fit. And like you, they didn't go to a gym or do so-called, you know, traditional training. They just lived a normal lifestyle.
Wow. This is going to be fun, man. So let's head in the garden and show you guys some of the exercises or just some of the gardening tasks I do and find out why it's so good for me and you guys, too. All right, John, so welcome to my backyard garden and actually my exercise gym, literally. It's this time of year right now and everything's pretty much overgrown because I have a really amazing summer season despite 100 plus degree weather. And as you can see, like I have lots of things that are overgrown, but on some levels, my overgrown plants actually benefit me because things overgrow and I don't have time to stake them or pin them up, but they're like growing over literally into the pathway. And as I'm in the garden, I have to like walk through and dodge them. So, I mean, is this some kind of functional exercise for me and how can it help?
Absolutely. So probably one of the most important exercises that I do with my clients is lateral movement. So I literally put them outside and we use what's called an agility ladder where they have to move laterally through like a ladder because we don't move enough sideways. We're always moving forward and we're never moving sideways enough. So that's why tennis and dancing and things like that are wonderful exercises. This is functional because now we don't have cement. We have ground and dirt and there's sticks and twigs and you got to be even more careful. So your nervous system is turned on. So it's like the 4th of July, so it's hypervigilant. And here, when you're moving laterally, that's one of the best trainings. And I noticed that you were moving and then rotating. That's a really advanced drill that I do. And where we move two steps to the right, then we rotate two steps to the left, and we keep rotating. It's so good for your balance and your mind.
Oh, wow, so I could even make it better than just walking down my path. And I turn because I'm like thinner this way than this way, so I don't like brush my kale plants, which might be dinner tonight, and just run through. And then I'll kind of flip back normal and keep going straight.
Wonderful. Perfect exercise.
So I could basically, I want to turn through here and then go straight and then maybe turn even if there's no more plants, right? To even get better exercise.
Yeah. It's like a dance.
Yeah, so you could be dancing in your garden. Woo, woo, woo.
Exactly.
Having fun, getting some of the best exercise. So yeah, you guys could incorporate some of these moves, you know, and dodging your plants when they're overgrown. And then even if you're not dodging them, hey, go back to that position to go sideways and keep reversing as if you're in one of John's training courses.
Yes, absolutely. One of my boot camps. And the other thing is make sure that if possible, you go barefoot as much as possible because it's that grounding, that connection to the earth. Mm. And remember too, heels are not healthy for you.
Yep.
It puts an unnatural strain on your back and they put a lot of pressure. That's why a lot of people get foot problems. They're putting so much pressure on the ball of their foot. It's not healthy. And as people get osteopenia or osteoporosis, eventually they get a little fracture there.
Wow. Yeah. And grounding so important, like being connected with the earth and grounding. Anyways, let's move on, John, and see what else we can learn.
Okay.
So what I'm doing now is I'm just basically carrying a bag of rock dust. Literally, this is just ground up rocks, one of the best things you guys can add to your garden to add trace minerals. But at the same time, I'm getting a workout. Kind of feel like one of those Egyptians back in the olden days that had to like make the pyramids, you know, carrying literally bags of rocks to get exercise. That's how they did the time of the nights, right? And all this kind of stuff. This bag of azomite could weigh 44 pounds. Some bags of soil I could weigh could be 50 pounds if it's wet or worm casting. So when you go to the nursery or the feed store to pick up this stuff, you got to carry it in and out of your car. You got to carry it in and out and around in your garden. So John, how am I getting work out by just carrying a bag of rocks?
Amazing. Well, actually with a lot of clients, believe it or not, I do something similar. We use actually a sandbag for
that. I mean, this is basically like
sandbag. It's basically like a sandbag, but this is real life stuff that they're not paying somebody to train them and they're not wasting time. You're doing something functional. So anytime we do like this unilateral, we use one side only, it really turns your core on because your core is preventing you from falling over.
Mm. So the other direction. Oh yeah, I could see I'm kind of like stabilizing,
exactly.
Putting weight this way. So I don't, fall over this way because the bag's heavy.
Exactly. And so it's also very good stimulating for your brain because you're using one side, right?
Mm.
It's actually what you're doing is healthier than if you were carrying two.
Oh,
so
wow.
It's better to do
So do more trips.
You do more
and
trips.
And do a right side and then a left side and keep going back and forth. So you get better and more exercise.
Yeah, now when you're carrying on your shoulder, that's great, but if you were to carry it just in one hand.
Yeah, like this.
And we call that a plate pinch, where you were taking like a plate, a weight, and pinching it. You're actually just holding it like that, which is incredible for your forearms. Most people in society today have very, very weak forearms. Their ability to grip and hold on to something is very poor. That's why most people can't do chin-ups or pull-ups. And this is one of the best ways to improve your grip strength.
Cool, and if I'm just not carrying, I can just sit here and use this as an exercise weight, like literally curl. So what does this work?
Well, yeah, that's, again, predominantly your biceps and your forearm, but yeah, you could. And what would be?
And then even up.
Going to a press, exactly.
Press. What other kind of, I can use this for so many things.
Now,
right?
Here's what's interesting. Since I'm traveling a lot, teaching all over the country, think about this and be honest with yourself. When is the last time the average person has put their hands over their heads?
Oh, wow.
Most people don't. So then you get on a plane and you try to put your luggage in the overhead, you know, bin, and that's how somebody blows out a rotator cuff. You know,
all right, one-handed
they don't have the
here.
Flexibility and they don't have the strength.
Well, imbalance.
Yeah. And so what you're doing now is what we do with a kettlebell, actually, because it's imbalance. So that's even more imbalance than a kettlebell because it's moving. So it's wonderful for your shoulders, your legs, your core, everything. It's perfect. But I would just caution everybody, you don't just start with a 40-pound bag.
Yeah, and this is half full, guys.
Yeah.
So, you know, and that's the cool thing. Once you empty it out, maybe you have to empty it out a bunch because you can't do all 44 pounds.
No.
Don't try to be the man. Don't try
no.
to blow out any kind of parts of you. You know, empty it to like maybe 10 pounds.
Yeah. Or hey, start out with a tomato.
Yeah.
Because a lot of people don't have the flexibility.
Oh,
just
wow.
Put their arm
yeah,
over
that's
their,
true.
Their head, you know? So you have to start
or
small.
Or a brick.
Well, yeah, because most people, again, other than you, how many people that are living in this community do this at least 10 times a day? They don't. So this flexibility and the mobility is poor. So you can't go from having no mobility and then go working 40 pounds. It takes time. So you have to work your way up to it, kind of steps on a stair.
Mm, cool. Yeah, I mean, the other thing is this whole side of my garden is built with these concrete blocks that I carried actually sometimes two or three at a time from my front yard to the backyard, and I picked up actually at the store that sold them. I had to load each one into my truck.
Yeah, amazing.
So that was like really good. Actually, I think I have an old Facebook picture on that, holding those blocks.
Yeah.
That was a really nice workout that day.
I mean, think when you go to a gym, you're paying for a gym to go on a bike and go nowhere, get on a treadmill and go nowhere. What if we got rid of our car? What if we biked more and we walked more? not only is you are you helping the planet, you're not putting all this pollution, but you have some quality time alone when you're walking, you're being outside with the sun and the greenery. But nothing could be better than being in the garden. You couldn't find a more therapeutic activity.
Yeah, as we're sitting next to my tree collards that are towering, I think 12 feet plus tall now. You want to talk really quick, John, because I know besides just the fitness part, you know a lot about diet and nutrition. So why are something like the greens so important for us to eat? I mean, my channel is called Growing Your Greens, not just for any random reason, because I want you guys to grow and eat greens.
Yeah, you know, I work a lot with, obviously, elderly people, and a lot of elderly people get macular degeneration. And, you know, they'll go and they'll get a prescription or a recommendation from their physician to get maybe 300 micrograms of lutein, which is important for the macula. You know, there's over 600 different carotenoids, and each carotenoid has a different function. But lutein happens to be one of the best for the macula. 300 micrograms sounds like a lot, but if you add a cup of kale, you've got 29,000 micrograms of lutein and zeaxanthin, which are important for the macula. So it's these green... The green plants are the most nutritious of anything we can eat. And in society today, we're lucky to maybe get 10% of our diet as plant matter. Everything else is processed in animal foods. So the civilizations, the cultures who have lived the longest, their diet is predominantly all plant matter, no processed foods, and maybe 1 to 10% of their diet is animal product. But mainly they're eating plant matter. And so we just don't get enough volume of plant matter. And that's why making blended soups and blended smoothies is so important, because it's a way to concentrate it in. Every sip that your child takes, or your mother or your father or your grandparents, is like eating a whole bowl of vegetables. So when you concentrate it into that smoothie or soup, it's life-saving for them. The two groups that are it's mandatory that has smoothies or blended soups is geriatrics, the elderly, because they don't masticate or chew well. They have poor hydrochloric acid, so they can't break apart that cell wall. It has to be blended for them. And children, because children don't eat enough. They have poor appetites. They're filling up on crap. So that's why it's so important to do like you do juicing, blended stuff. It's critical. But for most of us here who are willing to eat these big salads, we can't get enough of these greens in. And these are great just to use even as wraps.
Yeah.
Put a little guacamole in here or hummus and wrap that up and eat it. There you go.
Super simple. And then you don't have to buy tortilla shells, which are another processed product. Wow, great tips, John. So yeah, I mean, I like to vacuum blend. So that's the next level of blending. If you want to maximize some of the nutrients in your food, I have some videos on vacuum blending on YouTube if you want to look that up. And then the other thing I actually want to mention about that is, you know, every meal you make of a smoothie, a blended salad, blended soup, whatever you're doing, right? More importantly than getting the good stuff in, you're displacing the stuff that you would otherwise eat. That's why I love my little 10-year-old nephew comes over, because otherwise his dad is going to take him to Smashburger, although I got him to say, Dad, I don't want to eat Smashburger. I want to eat what Uncle John eats. You know, I feed him a smoothie, and then guess what? Now they have less room for eating the junk food in there, you know, depending on where you guys are at. I think that's a good... a technique that can help. Anyways, John, let's go ahead and move on and find out what other kind of exercises I get here in my garden. All right, so I always do so many different positions, and now we're going to talk about just how a simpler pruner, you can get an exercise. So John, what is this pruner doing for me when I'm like squeezing it like this?
Again, most of us are not using any resistance throughout our day. When you're using this, you're getting some quick movement here, and when you're snapping a branch or something, you're getting resistance. So it's improving your grip strength, which is important because most of us don't have good strength at all. Now, one thing I'd suggest is, as like you're an expert in the garden, start using your opposite hand a little bit. Now, watch when you switch.
Oh, did
you
notice it? Clumsy.
You're clumsy, so that again is stimulating the brain. As you notice, when he transitioned, he had to work to get that grip properly. And now he's trying to find that. That's wonderful for his brain, one of the best things for his brain. So only do it if it's safe. If you could use a remote control, you know, you don't want to pick up something hot. But like in a garden, if you're always raking this way, switch and rake this way. If you're always using your right hand, use your left hand.
Right.
And one of the things that's most important is our quadriceps here, our thighs, get very inflexible because our chairs, if you noticed in society, our chairs are getting higher and higher and higher. More people are actually using stools. And it prevents us from squatting down. This here, your whole quadricep is getting wonderful in terms of flexibility here because he's going all the way down. So one of the best stretches for people is actually what John's doing right now.
And yeah, I'm gonna also trimming my plants too, you know, stuff that I got to cut out that's going to seed. And the other thing is, I'll sit here and I'll chop up like piece, because all these little small pieces will go into my compost bin. And sometimes I try to, like, you know, like, actually here, I got a tree collard, I think, that just fell. Where'd it go? I had to cut off some tree collards, and, like, it's a really thick stalk, man, and it's, like, sometimes really hard to cut. I think it was up there somewhere. But, yeah, so that gives me lots of, like, grip strength. And don't they have those tools that kind of look like boxers somebody use?
Absolutely. A lot of martial artists, and they use them quite a bit in arm wrestling to get that better grip strength.
Yeah, so gardening and just pruning your plants, you're getting exercise.
Now, and, of course, the squatting is key. This is probably At the same time. Now, if you look at primitive civilizations, they don't have furniture, right?
So, or toilets.
Exactly. Well, so they're always squatting. They're constantly squatting. And you go to Indonesia, that's how they eat. That's how they play games. That's how they go to the restroom. So they're constantly in that, and they're constantly getting up and down. And they're 80 and 90, and they're still doing it. In our societies, you know, people start losing it. I have clients that come in 18 and 19. I've lost the ability to squat.
Wow.
Yeah. So the more that you're practicing this, if you don't have any physical injuries and your doctor's okayed it, the better off you are.
Yeah, so I love squatting, and then when I stand up, you know, try to stand up like one leg up and then come up, right? Yeah,
that's really
so
hard.
So I mean, that's like, so like every time I get up, it's like, all right, now if I ask me, John, get up on the left leg, a little bit harder, but I can still do it.
We call that a pistol squat.
So cool. So yeah, oh, and then John, I wanted to show you guys this tool. So like, I don't really use a lot of big shovels and like shovel dirt because I have a no-dig garden, which is very important to improve the soil, to not dig in it. So, you know, when I do dig, I basically use a tool like this that will literally take out a plug or a certain area of the soil. So actually I could get like a transplant. And so this is like, I have an edible leaf ballet tree here. And so like this tool is about the size of this guy. So I could basically just come in and take a plug in. Now how this tool works is, I don't have the name of this tool, but I think it's pretty cool. I've been using, it's called the Dirt Snatcher. Look at this thing. You got these like this handle here and this grip, and you like pull it back and forth. So John, does this relate to some kind of like tool that somebody could buy to exercise themselves when I'm actually putting it in the soil, right? And then I spin it. So look at this wrist action I get. I got a lot of wrist action, guys. Mm-hmm. You know, spinning my wrist to pull out a plug of dirt, and then I'm pulling and gripping this to make sure the dirt doesn't just fall out everywhere. And then I just basically put the dirt in an extra pot somewhere else, and then I like let it go. And then now I have a nice small hole to basically put my transplant in. That's perfect. That's disturbed my soil minimally. And also, evidently, I'm getting a workout. So what am I working out, John, dirt snatcher here?
It's so funny because they actually make a device like this for, you know, improving your grip that looks just like this, except down here is actually a weight. So when you're going like this, you're actually lifting a plate up. But it's just the exact same device. The only thing that this is better is you're getting that rotation because you're going against resistance with the dirt. So it's wonderful. Perfect.
Cool. Yeah, I mean, this is how I get my workouts, real world exercise, have fun, and grow my food at the same time. All right, guys, so one of my favorite garden tools in the garden that John says I'm getting an incredible workout every time I pick up one of these guys is right here. This is a 5-gallon bucket, and this is not empty. It's actually full of soil. So when I take those plugs out of the garden, it goes into a bucket, and then basically I will screen it and then put it into a new batch of soil that I'm making. And so I get to carry these all around my garden, you know, whether I'm like, once again, just kind of like the weights. I mean, this is already on a flexible. I could flex this and, you know, carry it. But in addition, you guys get like even a better one, 6.5-gallon, and all these buckets are rescued. I did not pay for a single bucket. I literally dumpster dive. Actually, this is really cool. This is out in the back of a pool supply store. This did hold chlorine tablets that I washed out really well. And this is a 6.5-gallon bucket. So when these guys get heavy, you know, I really get a good workout. And actually, I have one right here that's like half full. And as you guys can see, it's got all my food scraps from my kitchen. And actually, this is last night's juicing session. What do you think that weighs, John? Why don't you pick that up?
Oh my gosh, that's amazing.
I just have like 3 fingers on the little lip. And I mean, I deal with these things day in, day out, dealing with my food scraps, taking out to my composters, which will probably give you the best workout in the garden. You know, then I got to carry these. I try to get balanced, and like I could carry 2 at once, and I got to shuffle my way through the garden while I'm like going sideways and dodging plants that didn't get pinned up or trellised up. So John, you want to tell us about how functional a bucket, having it full with produce or, you know, soil or even just water can be?
One of the things that you were doing when you're carrying one in each hand, in the gym we actually call that a farmer's walk.
It's a gardener's walk. Doing it.
Yeah. So you actually will take plates, you know, weight plates like 45 pounds each or dumbbells, and you'll walk across the room with them. This is better because you see this action where they're moving.
Yeah. So that's you got to keep a little bit of better balance.
Yeah, and it's functional again. So again, what you were doing this for your forearms was amazing. I mean, you saw your forearms just blowing up.
That's why I got forearms, man. Amazing. It's like just garden.
What was amazing too is, you know, when you work with rock climbers, they do a lot of pull-ups on their fingertips. What you were doing was actually holding it like that, which was amazing. So yeah, but be careful with that because you don't just want to go right into it. It's really easy to hurt the tendons in your fingers. Mm. So you don't want to intentionally do that.
Yeah, no, I've been doing this for a long time, and every time I make it a game, like working in the garden is a game to me. It's fun. It's life. How could I pick this up differently, John, to work some different muscle groups? And I'm not the expert like you that knows all the muscles, but I know, hey, this is working this muscle, and it's going to be a little bit tired tomorrow, maybe.
Well, what you did, which most people can't do, is you were working your forearms like crazy. Mm. So this reverse curl, most people are going to do it with a curl action where you're stronger here than you are here. So that's why your forearms are so strong.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, they're amazing.
Yeah.
Your whole arms
are pretty
solid,
man.
Absolutely. And then again, all that twisting and turning you're doing in the guard. Now, one of the things that I like to do with a bucket is whenever you have liquid in here. So if you had water in here.
Yeah, which I do sometimes. Like, basically, I'll in the middle of the summer, my hose attracts the heat. The water in the hose will be really hot, so I can't just water my garden because I'll be watering the garden literally with 100-plus degree water. I'll basically fill up the bucket, like, half full, and then I'll carry this once it cools down to, like, my fig trees and dump it. So how should I carry it, or what kind of exercise should I do then?
When you put this, say, with half water and you're carrying it, since it's sloshing around, every time you're moving, it's sloshing, and you have to stabilize yourself so to prevent you from falling.
And from spilling the valuable water, which is a valuable resource.
And your arms are really having the fight because they're going forward and back and sideways constantly when it's sloshing. Now, a cool thing is if I'm working with a client, I literally can just take a bucket like this, put about half of it in water, and have them hold it like this, and then just gently rotate.
Oh, wow, and it's like sloshing.
It's sloshing. You put a top on it. But it's so incredible for your core because you're having to stabilize it. So normally, like we would use in a gym, we would do something called a Russian twist, where we'd have a cable machine or an exercise band and rotate like this, which is really good. But this, when you move very quickly left and right, it's phenomenal for your core.
Amazing.
Yeah.
All right, John, I think we're going to, let's go ahead and head through the garden. We're going to carry these, and we're going to dump in the composter, and I'll show you guys the amazing workout I get with my composter. So now we're in my compost alley, and if you want to learn the best composter, check the link down below. I've reviewed basically 12 different composters, and this guy right here is my favorite, and also it's the best one to work out with as well due to the specific design it has, with like a little handle here that you could grab, as well as little arm handholds here. What I'm going to do is empty out my compost buckets here, and I basically load this up. And, you know, I'm getting exercise, but also I'm building my soil at the same time by composting my food scraps, my waste garden clippings, and I just dump it in here. And we got a bunch of like wood pellets in the bottom, and you know, shredded paper, very important. And let's go ahead and get that one in there. Then we'll go ahead and close this guy up. And then what I do is very important. If you have a compost tumbler, you have to turn it and spin it to aerate the compost. You should optimally do this once a day. If you have a compost pile, then you should sit there with a pitchfork and flip it every once in a while to get some nice aeration. Then I gotta turn my compost tumbler like this. So what am I working out, John, when I'm doing this?
Some of the best back training in the world right here. I mean, I don't know if you could devise a better exercise device than this right here. I mean, this is basically simulating climbing. I mean, it's amazing. The amount he's working his lats here and his back is just astronomical, along with his forearms and his shoulder. It's a perfect exercise. I'm actually surprised they don't have this in a gym.
And then the other thing is I'll turn it that way, but then I'll be like, oh, I worked outside enough. Then I'll come this direction.
All triceps here. It's crazy. I mean, this is just crazy tricep work here.
Then the other hand, backwards.
Yep. So he's going into an advanced movement when he pulls it down. Then it's almost like a muscle up, what we do on a chin-up bar. It's pretty amazing.
And then, of course, we have my compost fully mixed up in there. And you can feel the heat on that, right, John?
Oh, yeah. Wow.
Yeah, so like just within 30 days in this insulated composter, you know, I'll have actually soil. Maybe we'll mix it up in a little bit when I make a soil batch. But anyways, I know you really love this composter because not only the standard handles that most composters have, but they have these side handles that really immolate the gym. So let me demonstrate. Oh, and try to tumble this, John. Tell me how much weight is in there.
I can't even barely move it. I could barely move it when you were doing it.
Like, how much weight is in there? Because I to me, it's just, I'm tumbling my compost. I'm thinking, I'm doing 100 pounds or 150 pounds.
It's just like, pounds.
It's just like whatever it is, that's what I'm having to push that day.
No, it's amazing. People would have to work out before they come here.
All right, cool. Let's go ahead and demonstrate this one here.
So this one's probably my favorite because there is a bike called a Schwinn Aerodyne or an assault bike where you're actually pushing and pulling all the time. And
I can go like this.
Yeah, you go up. Yep. So you can go from biceps to triceps. Yeah, this is probably one of the best exercises in the world for people who are in martial arts or wrestling, which you're doing here.
Yeah, push it
constant
up.
Constant pushing and pulling. I wouldn't be surprised if some gym now creates some sort of device with like this, because this is amazing.
Yeah, and you can tell with your compost
at the
same time.
And you can feel your core, because you're going unilateral again, so you're really using your core.
Yeah, and then pull down.
Yep.
And normally what I'll do is I'll just sit here, And sometimes, once again, I'll do like this, and I have to like push down hard enough to get it back down so I can continue the stroke, right?
So just like in weightlifting, we'll do tricep dips, so we'll do dips, or we'll do push downs. This is the same thing. It's even better, though.
Then another thing I do is I'll take and I'll just do like super slow, like just super slow to like build the resistance slowly instead of fast, and my muscle will start to shake a little bit.
Yeah, now so for clients, what you're doing now is I actually use a very thick, huge rope and they practice pulling it against my resistance. So it's the same thing you're
doing. And then if I want to even get a better workout, I can use like one finger, right?
That is amazing.
Oh, this one's a little bit hard.
You definitely don't want
your two fingers.
Practice that though.
Yeah, that's a lot of stress on your fingers. I mean, literally, I mean, I'm out here like, well, I try to get out here every day, but I constantly spin these tumblers because the more often you can spin them, the faster you're going to be done. John, are there any other exercises you could do on this guy?
I think the only thing that I would not recommend, but I'd probably recommend to you, is actually walking on top of this like Cirque du Soleil.
No, I don't recommend that one.
You ever seen Cirque du Soleil when they're
walking? Yeah. No, that's quite dangerous.
Absolutely.
I'm good with standing on the ground, but I mean, here's the thing, man. You know, I'm just gardening, getting real world exercise, doing things that are actually going to help me, help my garden, and even help the planet by composting my food waste. What if everybody did this, right? They could throw away their gym membership, get the Jura, the big Jura, fill it up and spin it to get a great workout.
And since so much of our soil now has been depleted of those trace minerals, like chromium, selenium, molybdenum, things like that, it's so important to have good, healthy soil.
Right, yeah. So composting and also, you know, adding that rock dust that I show. I think we got time, John, for one more tip from a viewer. So let's head over to a different part of my garden. As you guys can see, this is actually my wheelbarrow, and this is where I mix all the soil. So once I make my compost out of the compost tumblers, I'll mix that with Dr. Earth soil, rock dust, worm castings, soil humates, insect frass, like Alaskan humus, all kinds of stuff goes in here. Maybe some vermiculite, some perlite in there, coconut coir, you know, whatever I have on hand. And basically I hand mix this stuff, right? Because I really like to get my hands in the dirt. And John, am I getting a workout when I'm mixing this stuff up? Usually I do one hand at a time. I go to the bottom and try to get my hand underneath and then bring up a whole thing and get it up top just to mix, make sure all my rock dust is evenly distributed, all my worm castings are in there. So like, why is this good for me, like through a workout standpoint?
Well, when you're doing it with one arm, what a great chest workout, unilateral on one side, and when you scoop with both, it's just like doing a fly with weights.
Ah.
You've got this great resistance. And in martial arts training and for rock climbing, we use things like this to develop your grip. So going in there, grabbing it and moving it. Yeah, that's all.
Yeah, you usually don't grip it too much. I usually have like open hand, like I'm like, mm-hmm. I'm a shovel. I'm the human shovel here because I don't use shovels. I like to be connected with the earth. I mean, literally get it in my fingernails and smell it. And that's the other thing, right? Like they've proven in science there are beneficial microbes if you have proper compost and not if you have improper compost, because improper compost can actually kill you. But if you have got good soil microbes, there's microbes in here that'll actually make you feel good. So this is just, once again, sitting, getting grounded, touching dirt, smelling, getting full body exercise and workout. I mean, this gotta be better than a gym, right?
It's the greatest thing in the world. Now, in ancient China, what they would do is this exact same thing, but instead of sitting on a bucket, they would go into a horse stance.
Ah, so how do you do the horse stance?
So it would be just like that, a squat down.
So like this, I'm squatting?
And you would do the same movements.
Oh, wow.
Same thing.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So wait, it's like paint the fence.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, wax on, wax off.
Wax on, wax off.
Exactly.
Wait, I like the wax it off part. So anyways, yeah, so wow, so okay, so I'm gonna, sometimes I use the bucket, but a lot of times I just stand. I don't know if I crouch down this much, but you know, that's good.
Better.
I can start doing this. What if I like standing on one foot, right? I got one foot up, and now I'm mixing. Don't do that, but what if I stand on one foot and just balance, you know, on one foot while doing that? It's almost like a meditation.
Yeah, the squatting is key, because we're not gonna squat enough. So other than gardeners, we're not gonna squat enough, so.
Cool, all right, man. Well, maybe let's sit down and maybe talk a little bit before we close out this video, John, so people could learn more about getting the best exercise in your garden. John, wow, so man, I'm sweating after moving some of that compost, and I mean, you see the kind of work
Amazing.
I do, because I mean, I'm just working in the garden. I'm not like trying to get a workout. It's just, I just got to do this stuff to keep my garden growing, keep everything happening here, literally in the middle of the desert, to build good soil, to grow good plants that I could actually eat it, which fuels my body, which gives me all the energy fruits and vegetables power my body to give me all the energy. You've seen me do all the different things I do and turn those compost tumblers, and I'm thinking I'm weak, man. John, oh, you can't turn this, man, because it's freaking, because it's like so heavy, but you're saying it's like really heavy.
Very heavy. I couldn't believe it. I mean, it's amazing. I bet you're probably the strongest vegan out there that doesn't go to a gym.
Well, I like to say I like to eat plant-based. You know, I encourage you guys to eat more fruits and vegetables, whether you want to eat all fruits and vegetables, that's up to you, but the one thing is clear, too many people eat excess processed food and excess animal foods, and really the staple of the majority of our, overwhelming majority of our diet, if you want to live healthily, should be fruits and vegetables as well as other plants. All right, John, so you want to talk about, you know, the exercises that you've seen me do and probably others that I do in the garden, why, once again, just reaffirming why gardening is so beneficial for your health and why it's probably even the best exercise on planet.
Well, one of the challenges with going to gyms is, again, it's isolated training. It's not functional. You're not, you know, if for instance, say for instance, you have to do functional things in life, just lifting things over your head or carrying kids or groceries or rotating and moving, those things you can't really replicate in a gym. So like when you're at a gym and on a bench press, like when in life are you going to do that? I mean, if you got a flat tire and you didn't have a jack, right, somebody might do that, but it's not realistic. It's just not realistic. So all the stuff that I saw today that you do just before we filmed was amazing. I mean, how functional it was, and I couldn't recommend going to a gym for you at all. I couldn't even see you spending 5 minutes in a gym. There's nothing that you could really do in a gym that you can't get here, and I'd say this is probably 10 times better. And not only is it better for you, but it's better for the plant, you know, that you're out here and the planet, that you're in the soil, and just for your general spirit and psyche, it's so much better because you're connecting with nature. I think one of the biggest challenges we have in life in general is that in general, we don't connect at all. Yeah. We don't connect with ourselves, we don't connect with one another, and we definitely don't connect with nature. And so this is a way for you to connect with yourself, with nature, and if you gardened with somebody else and some friends, you're connecting with people.
Yeah, I need help on that front. Yeah, okay. But yeah, so, I mean, the other thing is too about, for me, it's all about time efficiency. The one thing we have, a limited amounts of resources, I mean, maybe a lot of you guys, it's money, but you know, for many people, it's time. That's the only thing that could be limited. We can maybe make a lot of money and all this kind of stuff, but time is a one finite resource that we all have, so I want you guys to invest it wisely. And for me, going to the gym and just pumping weights, it just seems like a waste of time, because what am I really doing? Okay, I'm building some muscles, I'm breathing stale air. Mm-hmm. It's like there's no purpose to like pumping weights aside from maybe building your muscles, and maybe if you're trying to meet somebody at the gym. But here, you know, I get to once again connect with nature, get sun, breathe fresh air. You know, my plants put out amazing fresh air for me. I get to grow my plants that I get to eat. I get to build the soil, get to have the beneficial microbes surrounding me, touching me on my skin that populate us, that are, you know, we're more microbe than human, they're saying now. And it's just so important to garden for many reasons. And as you guys learned today, it can be your best exercise if you actually work hard in your garden like I do and build up a sweat. So John, are there any questions that I should ask you about gardening or exercise that I really didn't get to ask you today, and what would be the answer?
Well, I would say as an organic gardener, to me, one of the most important things is that respect and that care for nature. Mm. I think a lot of people are constantly throwing out so much produce. Now, you've planted all this, you've seen it go from a little seed into what it is, and you want to develop that respect for the plants and for nature and not to ever waste anything. You know, I mean, it took a lot of time and effort for this to grow, and a plant is, you know, and you know, its whole life is here. And I think we should be very respectful when we eat our food. We eat with having reverence, you know, for that food, especially obviously plant food, and also thinking where that food came from. You know, being respectful when we eat that started as this tiny little seed, and it had to grow into a big plant. All these millions of microorganisms, the sun, the water, all the care that went into it. We should spend some time before we eat our meal being respectful. And also, now I know I'm different than probably a lot of other people because I became vegan 36 years ago or so for ethical reasons. When I have a garden, I actually want bugs to eat my plants. I want to allocate a certain amount of that plant or part of the garden for the bugs. I mean, that we have refrigerators and cabinets, they don't. They need to eat too. So I don't mind them eating. And here's the other thing. Every time a bug eats a plant, the antioxidant level of that plant is increased dramatically because it looks at it as a stressor.
Yep.
So it's producing more antioxidants. So if I see a plant, a piece of kale that it's got bug holes in, I was like, oh my God, so many more antioxidants in that plant. And I think to myself, this is so wonderful that a little insect got to enjoy the garden.
Wow. That's a different take on things, right? So, you know, I have a more balanced approach. Like if I see some bugs, I'm not like instantly spraying stuff because I don't want to, once again, if you spray anything, even organic pesticides and pest controls, right, they can affect beneficial bugs and soil microbes and things. So I really, you know, my goal is to not have to spray any kind of even organic pesticides in my garden. You know, so actually I have a video on spraying high pressure air. You know, maybe I'll put a link down below to that video. Also spray high pressure water, which are my favorite, two favorite things to spray. Then I might smush some bugs if I have really bad outbreaks, because I don't want to, you know, have too bad outbreaks and have it spread. But the goal is, if you have really good soil, you're going to grow high quality plants that literally bugs are not attracted to, and then they could go somewhere else. And the other thing is, I also, John, will, like, you know, I plant extra just to make sure that I'm going to eat. And if the bugs or nature want some, you know, then they also get to eat as well. And I'm not super paranoid. The other thing I like to do is I like to use nature against nature. So, you know, every year now I've been releasing praying mantis eggs. So you might see some of my pet praying mantises that I've also been known to feed. I'll catch a bug off this plant and then I'll find the praying mantis. I'll just feed it, put it right up to his mouth. He'll start eating it. I think I have an Instagram picture on that, actually. But it's just so fun for me to see nature work and not think, oh, it's a bug, I must smush it, right? Let's think about these things. You know, there's many, everything in life is not good or bad. You know, it's all shades of gray. So I want you guys to have an open mind and, you know, let some bugs live once in a while, you know, and you got to assess the situation. A few aphids are probably good, increase some antioxidants, but yeah, too many, they could take out your garden, then you're not eating, and that's the point where I really have to step in when I have a big outbreak. Then I might spray some non-toxic sprays like the Dr. Zymes. Put a link down below, because that's a non-persistent organic pesticide that literally you spray it on, it acts on contact within 5 minutes here in the desert, it's evaporated, it's gone, and like there's no residual effects on beneficial on bees or anything else, because it just evaporates literally. So yeah, very important wise words, John. So I mean, we're coming to an end here, but I want you guys to be able to like talk about what you're doing in your life, because I mean, I know you're not gardening, but you actually rescue other things in life. I rescue plants, but what are you doing?
So basically, you know, I travel around the country, obviously lecturing at different conferences, and then I work with people individually one-on-one. I'm trying really hard to open up a retreat center in Animal Sanctuary in Boulder, Colorado, where there'd be an environmental center and, of course, massive amounts of gardening. So people can come and we can run retreats there throughout the year.
Oh,
so
cool.
If you go to livingwithharmony.org, that's our website, and you can sign up for our newsletter. And we have this free PDF download, because we created a term called planet-based living.
Planet-based living. Mm-hmm.
And so basically it's not plant-based, it's planet. So everything that we do in our life, my co-founder Andrea Rose and I, and she created the term planet-based living, is all about respect for people, for, you know, all of humanity, all insects, all animals, and of course the planet. Mm. So we try to avoid all single-use plastics, we avoid palm oils, we try to avoid things that take its toll on humanity. And look what's happening now in the Amazon.
Yeah,
you
terrible.
Know, it's just unbelievable. So we need to start being conscious of things, because remember, you know, Dr. Michael Clapper once told me, he goes, you know, when you throw something away, wears away.
Yeah.
And you have to think about that. On my garbage can that I have, I actually have it written there, when you throw something away, wears away. So I'm very conscientious. I want almost everything that I have to go and compost. I really don't want there to be wrappers and packaging and things like that. So that's one of the things that Living with Harmony does. I also work with this organization, Project Child Safe, which is an organization that basically rescues children in trafficking around the world.
Oh, wow.
So I do a lot of work with them in trying to collect funding for them, educate the population about trafficking. And then what I do is, for the kids, when they get rescued, I collect dolls and shoes and vegan candy bars for them, so when they get rescued, they have something nice, because many of them don't even have shoes.
Wow.
So we do a lot of different projects out in Colorado. We run the Boulder Colorado Pet Pantry, which is for the homeless and low income, providing foods for their animals. So we're constantly doing something for humanity. And one of the things that I'd suggest you do is, no matter what you can do activism wise, just do some sort of activism. Alice Walker said that activism is your rent for living on the earth.
Mm.
So you can't just be doing always things for yourself. Just do something, no matter what it is, even if it's just signing a petition or anything that, you know, just to make the world a better place.
Yeah, and actually that's why I make the videos, to share with what I'm doing. And I mean, I never thought of like all the stuff I do is exercise, just what I got to do. But at the same time, I mean, that's why I'm fit and in shape, because I am doing real world exercise that's helping the planet at the same time. So I'm glad. So John, if somebody wants to get a hold of you for your fitness training or learn about more about your organization, what are the websites and all that stuff? I'll post the links down below as well.
Sure. So it's livingwithharmony.org. And then johnpierre.com, you'll see me training Ellen DeGeneres on there. So there's kind of like a little video of my boot camp. So you'll see that. And then my email is foods, F-O-O-D-S, like Sam, for F-O-R, life, L-I-F-E, J-P, at Yahoo.
All right, cool. Cool. Yeah, so check John out. Links are down below. Once again, he's got to get running. He's got to go to his next client. So anyways, if you guys enjoyed this episode, hey, please be sure to give this video a thumbs up. I get like 1,000 thumbs ups. I'll make more videos with John. Go out of my way to connect with him, because I had a fun time with this, and hopefully you guys did too, and learned truly the value of gardening. you know, for being physically fit as well as, you know, eating the foods, which I have plenty on videos on making recipes and all that kind of stuff. Also, be sure to share this video with somebody else that's a vegan, somebody else that's a meat eater, paleo, somebody that goes to the gyms and works out all the time, think they're getting the best workout. Well, they can learn about some of the benefits of gardening and getting a big drawer form compost tumbler, which John said is probably the best exercise equipment on the planet. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you never know what you're going to learn or on my YouTube channel. I come out with videos every 3 to 4, maybe every 7 days. You know, I'm an outside of the box thinker, and there's no other videos on YouTube gardening on exercise that I'm aware of until now. So that's the kind of videos I put out. And make sure to click the little bell so you get notified as my new videos come out. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge. Over 1,500 videos at this time on this YouTube channel dedicated to teach you guys how to grow your own food and eat more plant food so you guys get healthy. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.